Hello everyone, I am Nazia Fatima and I welcome you today to our interview session. In today's round, we have a very special guest. He began his career from being first Muslim chartered accountant from Karnataka. He is a veteran politician belonging to Indian National Congress Party. He has been former Union Minister of Minority Affairs and ex-deputy chairman of Rajya Sabha. Not only that, he has also been chairman of Central Work Council and chairman of Alameen Society. Along with his political involvement, he has also been very much engaged in the field of journalism and social work and many more. I welcome Mr. K. Rahman Khan. I welcome you, sir, today to our interview round.
I would begin my interview with my first question. That is, how would you describe your journey from being chartered accountant to being former Union Minister of Minority Affairs?
It's a long journey, Nazia. I am basically, apart from being a chartered accountant, I am a social worker. Mm-hmm. I have been in the field of education. I'm part of the Alameen Education Society, which is one of the foremost education society of India. Then, alhamdulillah, when UPA came, I became the Minister of State for Chemicals and Fertilizers. Then the party asked me to assume the responsibility of the Deputy Chairman of Rajya Sabha. Mm. So I was there for about 9 years. Then the party inducted me into the cabinet of Manmohan Singh as Minority Affairs Minister. But I continued to do my social work. I never detached from my basic work of education. And I have highlighted my experience in a book called My Mamaids, which is published. And it is, which highlights the journey and also various problems we encounter. And also the community, how the Muslim community, who is responsible, how political, almost 50 years of my political and social and economic life has been, I have detailed in my memoirs.
Okay. So moving on to the next question, you have been the chairman of Central Work Council. So what are the challenges you faced there? And how did you deal with the issues of encroachment of work property?
See, when work was a very, very dear subject to me. Mm-hmm. As a social worker itself, from 1972, I was associated with WAQFs. So I was a very active member, alhamdulillah. And there I initiated that we have to develop these properties. Encroachment is because we are not developing these properties. Mm-hmm. We are left like this open field, no fencing, nothing, nobody is bothered. Mm-hmm. And so this encroachment is natural. Anybody, if you are not taking care, even if your house is open, anybody will enter and stay in the house. That is the encroachment. Mm. So there is nothing. So unless we develop. So I initiated a measure that there should be a body to develop these work properties. Mm. So I initiated that there should be a development corporation. Mm. So, with my active involvement, the Karnataka Board of Waqf established a Karnataka Waqf Development Corporation. Mm-hmm. In 2012, I became the Minister of Minority Affairs. I said two things. One is a National Waqf Development Corporation should be set up, which is the recommendation of the JPC as well as Sachar Committee. Mm-hmm. Even Sachar Committee has recommended there should be a Waqf Development Corporation. So I said that I will, under the work, I will do two things. By virtue of my Minority Affairs Minister, I was the chairman of the Central Work Council also. Mm-hmm. The Central Work Council earlier was a toothless body. It was just an advisory body. They can advise only to the government, central government. they have no role to play in the regulating or in controlling the. So if there is no body which can control or regulate, it is of no use. And the Central Work Council has absolutely no toothless body. So some of the changes I brought in the Act of 2013 is to give power of direction to the Central Work Council. Today, the Central Work Council can give direction to any of the work board if they are not working properly, if they are not implementing the work back properly, and if they under the case of if they are not developing the work party, they can give direction. Suppose if the state government under whose control the work boards are there, or the work board refuses to carry out the direction of the work board, Central Work Council, it should be referred to a tribunal by the Supreme Court. Mm-hmm. So thereby, it is the work council has now a lot of power. They will not listen to the Central Work Council. So this is the one great thing, great change I brought in the Central Work Council. The second thing is the establishment of a work development corporation, which is historical and which is I within 1 year, because usually governments always there will be set up a corporation 2 years, 3 years. In a short period of 6 months, I set up the National Work Development Corporation, which was inaugurated by the then Prime Minister Manmohan Singh with 500 crores capital. Of course, the Work Development Corporation is still there, but from last 6 years, it has not functioned properly.
Mm-hmm.
And then the important changes we brought in the Act is very important because the encroachment definition we have changed.
Mm-hmm.
There was no proper definition of what is encroachment.
Okay.
Then they used to go to the courts and get stay. And it was not. Now today, the encroachment, the definition of encroachment in law is very simple. If anybody is occupying or staying in a work property, if he is not having a valid document, or if he is even having a lease and the lease has expired, or the work board has, or the mutwali has cancelled the work lease, it is an encroachment. There is no other shortcut to delay. See, these are the three things required to be encroached. If there is no document, he is an encroacher. If there is no agreement, it has lapsed, it is an encroacher. If there is agreement has been annulled by the work board or the mutwali, is an encroacher. An encroaching is we have brought it to the criminal offense. So now, in the Waqf Act, an encroacher can be straight away prosecuted.
Yes, sir.
And so this is some of the major changes and development we have brought. And alhamdulillah, the amended Act came into force from November 2013.
So do you think that Indian Muslims benefit from government's scheme and opportunities and programs?
You see, the Indian Muslims benefiting from the government program, first of all, the programs are not, it's a common program. There is no, you see, if you analyze it, there is no special programs for Muslims. But what the governments usually do is, in the existing program, a certain, out of that budget, they transfer certain budget, saying that it is a budget for minorities.
Yeah.
But the problem, even whatever it is, we are not benefiting. Problem thing is, in fact, when I was a minister, I told that I thought why the schemes are not reaching to the people at the grassroots level.
Yeah.
Because the implementing agency is the state governments.
Yes.
whatever benefit, whatever schemes the central governments will bring for the minorities or even other sections of society, they have to be implemented through the state government. Now, if the state government don't take interest, for example, as a minority affairs from the my ministry, we had several programs on the scholarship program we had.
We have
area development thing. We used to send money to the state government. Some of the state government used to keep that money, 100 crores or 200 crores or like that, in the, without utilizing it. In fact, I told I held discussion with all the chief ministers. And then, so the implementing is sturdy, plus there is some sort of a discrimination at the bureaucratic level. They don't take any enthusiasm in implementing. Yes, it is there, we have to do it, they will do it. They will not take proactive interest in reaching out to the minority. That is why the minorities also are ignorant, illiterate. They will not be having the programs. So minority level, at the level of minority, one is they are not reaching because we don't have adequate NGOs. You see, all programs are implemented in most of the government program through NGOs also. So there are hardly any NGOs. There are non-Muslim NGOs who are nothing to do except it is people used to misuse the funds and they used to take and they never used to implement it. So yeah. We have to create more NGOs and to understand the government scheme and to take it, reach it to the people. We hardly have any NGOs. We have Jamaas, we have the various religious NGOs, but social NGOs, we are not even 5% of the others who are having it. Mm-hmm. So the programs are not reaching, not because there are no programs. There are some programs, but those programs also not benefiting the Muslims.
Okay. So how do you think Muslim bodies should deal with the government, current ruling government?
You see, it is a very big subject.
Yeah.
The Muslim bodies have to reform.
Okay.
The Muslims particularly have a wrong notion that we have minorities, we are minorities, we have constitutional rights, we should get this, we should get that, we should get this benefit. So we have become a community of seekers from the government. The government should do this, government do that. In a diverse society, the Muslim bodies have not defined their role. The Muslim bodies somewhere practice exclusivity, not inclusive. Partition took place. We have not the Muslim community from last 70 years. We have not understood. We are only in a false notion that we will be protected. The political parties, or the secular political parties, gave them shelter. They gave them some minimum support. They didn't give us anything beyond that, whether it is Congress, whether any other so-called secular parties. They didn't bring any legislation, because we should go back to some of the letters written by Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru in 1950, as early as 1950 and 1953, to the various chief ministers of state, showing this apprehension. He has also apprehended these things may happen.
Mm-hmm.
So the chief minister should take adequate, that they will not get employment, they will not be in the police service, they will not, all that. There are two very important letters. Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru had written to all the chief ministers on these issues. So it was known. Where were our leaders? Why? They are only in Aligarh University's dispute, Urdu dispute, then we got Shahbanu's case, we got Babri Masjid cases. So these are the things we got involved, our Muslim organizations and Muslim leaders, religious leaders. They said Islam is in danger, personal law, all this we got involved and embroiled it in from last 70 years. So now we are facing the music today. We can't, so what is the use of blaming? Right now, the entire community should introspect. Instead of putting blame on others.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, there is total discrimination. We have not been treated well, economically, educationally, culturally, everything we are backward. I think you have to tackle your backwardness. You have to tackle your economic, this thing. Nobody will come and help. In a diverse society, nobody will come to your help. They have their leaders. The religious leaders have done excellent work for their own community. There is nothing wrong in it. If I do something for my community, for the economic, social, my community is part of my country. We are part of the country. When we plan micro level, I have every right to look after my community. The constitution gives me that right. So nobody prevented from you from establishing educational institutions. Nobody prevented you from establishing economic institutions. Nobody prevented. Take for example how Azim Premji, he's a Muslim.
Yes.
And he became the world's richest man in India. There are several such stories.
Mm-hmm.
Have they become that only because of the government help or they are this thing? Now they are respected in the society.
Yes.
Dr. Kalam is respected in the society. There are several achievers in the Muslims who are respected in the society. So it is the duty of the leaders of the society, whether religious and social and political leaders. We have to do that. You see, we have never planned. There is no unity. Ego, all the leaders, mm-hmm. religious leader, political leaders, so active socialist, social worker, they suffer from ego. I am right, the other is wrong. So unless you carry that ego, you will never be succeeded. Then among Muslims, this is very, so he is doing it, he is wrong. I am doing it, I am right.
Mm-hmm.
So this cult has developed on our leadership, both religious and why there are so many divisions in Islam. Why there is Shia, Sunni, this and all that. How do you develop? So we are more responsible for our backness than any other person or the government.
So how do you think there can be improvement in the socio-economic status of Indian Muslims?
You see, we have to... Yes, this is inshallah, my very soon, another 2-3 months, my book is coming on this same issue.
Okay.
Indian Muslim, the way forward.
Mm-hmm.
So I have given in my own way, I have given certain, I am writing some suggestion. The thing is, we have to concentrate. Gone is gone. 70 years are gone. Now what we have to do is, the Indian Muslims should not bother about whether they have political representation, they have this representation. In this, we have lost 70 years. You have to establish education institutions. You have to invest, the community has to invest in the education institutions. You have to establish economic institutions. You have to institutions which will, and then make a Muslim to useful to the society. Today, why we are not respected? We are not useful to the society.
Yeah.
Because we are poor, we are this, and we are charged with so many things. We are called terrorist, we are called Islamophobia, all sorts of things we are suffering. Every Muslim is today suffering with the guilt that they are, I'm not able to do anything. They are false, they are leveling charges. They are such a good religion, they are demonizing the religion. The Indian Muslims, unless he convert himself to a giver, he will not be respected. A seeker is not respected. A beggar is not respected. A person who is always lamenting, he is not respected. We have the power to become a giver. That is why Allah Ta'ala, Subhanahu wa Ta'ala has directed to give zakat.
Yeah.
That you earn and pay zakat. So that is the quality God has given to us. That is the responsibility God has entrusted to us. Today, see, the biggest thing is ego. Every one of us has an ego. This ego is killing the community. The division in Islam is because of his ego. It is not because of Quran and Sunnah. Huzur Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam and Quran never says all these things. No way, where is the Quran? This is interpretation which we are fighting for. It is, my interpretation is right, so my followers should have this interpretation. My interpretation is right, my followers should follow this. So this is the egoistic tendency among the religious leader. Then it has percolated to the political leaders. It has percolated to the intellectual class. You see, even our intellectual class, once he becomes an intellectual, he has attained certain level, he says, I am the right man. My opinion should prevail. So there is no body, consultative body. There is no apex body. There is no coordination between Muslim religious institutions, the social institutions. Each suspect others. I criticize the religious institution, they criticize the political leader, they criticize the... We are, in spite of all this, we are not learning a lesson.
All right. So this was Mr. K. Rahman Khan who enlightened us about his long political career and about issues associated with Waqf property. He also emphasized how Indian Muslims should not be dependent on others. Rather, they should be focusing on self-growth and development and be useful to the society. I wish him luck for his upcoming book titled Indian Muslims, The Way Forward, which talks about socio-economic status of Indian Muslims. Thank you so much, sir, for speaking to us. Thank you so much. Have a great day ahead.